Good morning, everyone, and welcome to this fourth installment of our webinar series on ethical issues raised by the COVID-19 pandemic. Let me begin by sharing my slides here. And they are right here. I want to say a few words about the Nordic Committee on Bioethics first. It was founded in 1989 to promote Nordic cooperation and exchange of information between scientists, parliamentarians, opinion leaders, and public officials in the area of bioethics. And the secretariat is provided by Nordforsk. The main task of the committee is to organize two or three conferences every year on bioethical issues relevant to the Nordic countries. The pandemic has meant, of course, that we have had to move our activities online for the time being, but you can see them all on our website at ncbio.org. Another task of the committee is the publication of an overview of legislation on biotechnology in the Nordic countries. The committee is multidisciplinary and has two members from Denmark, Finland, Iceland, Norway, and Sweden, and observing members from the Faroe Islands and Åland. Our webinar today is part of a webinar series with keynote speakers from our member countries. So far, we've had a keynote from Finland asking whether crisis leadership can be ethical communication, from Sweden on ethical choices in a pandemic from a Swedish perspective, and from Norway on the bioethical approach to priority settings of vaccines. On April 21st, we will have a keynote from Denmark. Today, we have a keynote from Iceland on justifying policy choices in a pandemic. And as you can see on this program for today, the keynote will be followed by commentaries from Norway and Denmark. Kristine Bærøe is Associate Professor at the Department of Global Public Health and Primary Care Bergen Center for Ethics and Priority Settings. And Janne, Rothmar, Herrmann is at the Center for Advanced Studies in Biomedical Innovation Law at the University of Copenhagen. And she is also a member of the NCBIO. Toward the end of this webinar, there will be time for questions and answers. So everyone in the audience is invited to post questions as you listen to our speakers, and we will do our best to have them addressed in the Q&A session. And so please use the Q&A option on your screen for posting your questions. Our keynote speaker today is Vilhjálmur Árnason, Professor of Philosophy and Chair of the Center for Ethics at the University of Iceland. He's the author of a vast number of research articles, books and book chapters on topics within several areas of philosophy, including existentialism, the history of ethics and moral thought, bioethics, the ethics of genetic research, civic responsibility of science, and democratic theory. The title of his talk today, Justifying Policy Choices in a Pandemic, is characteristic of his penchant for examining bioethical issues in their social and political contexts, and highlighting the moral aspects of public decision-making. So Vilhjálmur, please take the stage.
Thank you very much, Sigurður. Thanks for the introduction, and thanks to the NCBIO for inviting me to speak in this interesting webinar series. I should have added to my title, Justifying Policy Choices in a Pandemic, the case of Iceland, but I guess that was clear in the description. Because where it says that I will discuss the handling of the Icelandic authorities of COVID-19, in light of both substantial and procedural principles of public health ethics. And here I refer to, for example, an excellent overview article by Childress and his co-writers, mapping the terrain of public health ethics. And my discussion is framed in terms of the political philosopher David Miller's analysis of what he calls three elements of good political judgment, which is found in his excellent small book on introduction to political philosophy, a very short introduction. And I also draw upon a student's report. There are four students of ours here at the Department of Philosophy who wrote a very good report on the Icelandic case called, it's unfortunately only available in Icelandic, but the English title is Philosophical Challenges in Pandemic Times, where they analyzed the Icelandic or the handling of the Icelandic pandemic from the perspectives of political philosophy, philosophy of science, applied ethics, and feminist philosophy. And this report was published by the Center for Ethics at the end of last year. And this report involves or has interviews with some of the main figures in the handling of the pandemic in Iceland, and the direct quotes from that are from the report without acknowledging that each time. Now, the David Miller's framework is composed of what he calls three elements of good political judgment. The three elements are, first, factual information. A good policy decision or political judgment should be made on the basis of the best available knowledge. And here, the question is then, what has been the role of knowledge, uncertainty, and experts in the handling of the pandemic in Iceland? Secondly, a good policy decision should take into account the moral principles at stake and ask how, and here I ask, have moral values and fair procedures been properly adhered to? So, and I point out here that it's both substantial moral values and of course, the sort of democratic procedures that are very important both for in the public health discussion. And last, third element in Miller's frame is people's interests and preferences. How do we know that the policies are acceptable to the public? Now, to the first factor of the three, the knowledge factor, I think it can be said that it has been distinctive of the handling of Icelandic authorities, how prominent the role of experts has been. We have talked about the Troika, persons, one, the chief epidemiologist, and who has been sort of at the forefront of this, has been, had the main role in the decision making, and the National Director of Health, who was, of course, the main officer of health authorities in Iceland, and an officer from the Department of Civil Protection and Emergency Management. These three, which we have called þríeykið in Icelandic, or the Troika, or the threesome, have been at the forefront of the handling of public policies. And politicians have stayed in the background and not come out very much directly or much less directly in sort of explanation and justification of the policies, but have followed the recommendations of the chief epidemiologist, while of course acknowledging their accountability for this affair. Now, I think this arrangement has worked very well, and there has been and the handling of the pandemic has largely, I think, been in line with processes of public accountability as they are described in or defined in public health ethics, where the main sort of the main emphasis is on, sorry about this, there's something, is on transparency and publicity about the reasons for a decision, to explain these reasons and justify publicly, provide honest information based on critical scrutiny of evidence for the decision. And I think this has been, all of this has been very characteristic of the handling of the Troika of the pandemic in Iceland, and has been very much appreciated by the public. And last but not least, as Childress and his co-writers put it, the emphasis on expressing rather than imposing community. There has been a sort of an ongoing dialogue with the community, very much in the spirit of these moral ideas or procedural ideas of public accountability.
Sorry for the interruption. Could you please start the presentation show again? Thank you.
Yeah, if I do that, then I don't see the full, that's the problem that I'm having. And I see all the, well, perhaps that's my, yeah, sorry. Now, it has been part of this good handling of policy making that criticism has been welcomed and met politely with arguments as a rule. Now I mentioned here a special case which has to do with an attempt that was made to convince the drug company Pfizer to use Iceland as a site for a fourth phase clinical trial of the effects of their vaccine. This attempt was led by the chief epidemiologist and the CEO of Decode Genetics, the major research company here in Iceland. The role of politicians was less clear here. The prime minister met once with the spokesmen of the company, but mainly it was these two that were handling the negotiations. Now, when it looked like that a negotiation would be in place, that the project would actually materialize, I and four of my colleagues wrote an article where we posed several questions about the usefulness, democratic legitimacy, and fairness of the intended project. This had not really been discussed at all publicly. And we said that, argued that this called for a public debate. This was mostly put in terms of questions. Now, the response that we received was a bit characterized by irritation and implied that the questions were premature and this would be handled by experts and authorities in due course. Now, I think it's worth mentioning here in the knowledge factor that the research company Decode Genetics played a significant role in handling of the pandemic and a generous role. For example, by targeted testing, population screening, and sequencing of the virus, which I think contributed substantially to the success of handling this case here in Iceland. But this gave also the company a powerful position to influence policy and even take part in healthcare-related services, which sort of blurred the boundaries that are to be in place between research and healthcare. This is something that I think needs to be looked into sort of in the wake of this whole episode. Now also, there was no, for example, when the company was very much involved in screening at the borders, but no negotiation was in place with the company. And so the personal whims of the CEO were sort of a bit characteristic of the whole affair, and it was hard to foresee sometimes what procedures would be in place. Also, I would like to mention a serious incident here at the beginning of the pandemic, when the CEO accused the Icelandic Data Protection Agency of criminal behavior when the agency didn't meet his request of expressly handling an application for the screening project. When the spokesman of the Data Protection Agency wanted to have a bit more time to scrutinize the application and estimate whether it involved research or not. when the CEO came out in this way, I think it may have contributed to fear of the pandemic among the public and distrust of regulators, which I think needs to be avoided in a situation like this. Now, some lessons and questions here in relation to this first part of my presentation. I think that the preparatory work in control of infectious disease combined with experience of handling of emergencies here in Iceland has proved very successful. I think this, I don't know how it is exactly in other countries, but I think this sort of merging of infectious disease control and handling of emergencies, disasters, natural disasters that we have much experience of here in Iceland has proved very successful, and there has been good coordination of many parties that come into this affair. And I think it is commendable to use trustworthy and sincere experts in a pandemic situation. However, the team was limited to expertise in medicine, epidemiology, emergency, and biometrics, which I think has proved very efficient, but a question is whether that is too narrow. I just leave that as a question here. Now, care needs to be shown. I think the case about the vaccine affair shows how we need to be careful in transfer of trust in an area where factual information is crucial, as has been the case in the sort of control of the pandemic generally, to another area where moral values play a larger role. And that's why we, the philosophers, asked the question about the necessity of a democratic public discussion when all kinds of new questions arise when a nation is trying to get ahead of other nations in the vaccination phase. But of course, the fourth phase trial was justified by these chief epidemiologists by the fact that if Iceland would become a trial nation here, that would contribute to it would be useful for other nations on the globe. But the amalgam of public authorities and private company in this affair calls for a scrutiny, I think. And it must be asked whether it is defensible to give a private research company such an extensive role in the handling of the pandemic, at least without making it very clear exactly what its role is. Now, secondly, the moral factor, the primary aim of policy choices in a pandemic is avoiding, preventing, and removing harms. This should be done by employing effective measures with the least infringement of civil liberties and fair distribution of the burdens created by the measures. In light of statistics, Icelanders have been successful in reaching this main aim of public health policies. Mortality has been low. The public has responsibly employed personal preventive measures, and the healthcare system has creatively and effectively dealt with the pandemic by testing, tracking, isolating, and treating. And I think there has been an ingenious sort of handling of the pandemic by the National Hospital with a very effective outpatient department that contributed to the fact that the healthcare system could function very well throughout this throughout this time. Now, emphasis has been on cooperation rather than coercion, as I mentioned, and here in Iceland there has been less infringement of liberties than in most other countries. There's never been a total lockdown. There has been sort of a partial lockdown and of course restriction on gathering, but kindergarten and primary schools have stayed open. And for large amounts of time, for example, swimming pools and gymnasium have stayed open. Now, the initial justification for restrictive measures was to flatten the curve so as to avoid overburdening the healthcare system. But later the emphasis was moved to minimizing the number of cases, for example, by restrictions at the border, which would create more leeway for people and services within Icelandic society. Now, economic arguments actually were provided for against sort of relaxing restrictions at the border at the end of the summer. And but there were also arguments, of course, for because we have a very strong tourism industry. And so there were also arguments for enlivening that by relaxing the measures. And here I have a quote from the Icelandic Prime Minister on August 17 last year, where she is sort of thinking about this balancing. The government needs to strike a certain balance, she says. When we say that we are infringing on the rights of people to cross the border, it is true that we are burdening people, but we are not preventing them from crossing the border. We are, of course, curtailing rights of people in this country in their daily lives. I can mention people in nursing homes, our young people who are going to school and may expect to be in distance learning if things continue as they are more or less this winter. Now, we are in a way repeating this discussion now, because now there are plans to change policies at the border and to relax them, and critics are afraid that this may restrict the mobility among Icelanders in the summer to come. Now, while the measures have been effective in managing the pandemic, they have had and are likely to have serious and various consequences for public health. This has been acknowledged by here as elsewhere by extensive economic packages meant to mitigate these effects. Keeping schools for the youngest open may have prevented higher rise in domestic violence. It has been on the increase, but I think the attempts have been made by having the schools open to keep that, try to avoid that would rise even more. Now, the main emphasis has been on protecting the most vulnerable population, but long-term effects are likely to harm the young and the marginalized. Now, I think, as has been proposed, that to examine the alternative in order to make more informed choices is unrealistic. We don't know what to compare, and the data on public health costs, for example, statistical lives lost in the future as a consequence of measures to control the pandemic are, I think, unreliable. And all kinds of things can change in reality that we can't foresee. So rather than undertaking a utilitarian calculation of costs and benefits, an appeal, I think, is made to maintain moral intuitions about solidarity with the most vulnerable and our common interest in maintaining functioning healthcare institutions. This is what I call ethics of uncertainty, that it is dangerous to calculating the public health cost in the future lessen our protection of the most vulnerable in the situation as we face it here and now. I think we need to look into our eyes. We need to be able to face the consequences of our decisions in light of our solidarity with the weakest. The main slogan, "We are in this together," puts this in a nutshell. It has been characterized by compassion and at least attempt to have fairness in the distribution of burdens. Now, conditions in Icelandic society with easy border control, homogeneous, literate, small population with good access to welfare services are, of course, very favorable. Icelandic authorities didn't face as many difficult ethical questions that were prominent in most other countries, for example, about prioritization in the healthcare setting. The normative force of the approach must also be assessed in light of the expected time frame of the pandemic. We always thought that this would be sort of a relatively short period, and the hope for rapid vaccine development may have been motivating also. Now, here I have kind of a picture that, in addition to what I have said, sort of adds these role-specific norms there at the top, especially the sort of the theoretical preconceptions of policymakers that I think we are relevant here. Now, the main lessons and questions that I raise here are the importance of strong social institutions and services which contribute to equality. I think this has been a lesson learned throughout the world about from the pandemic. The vulnerable have been seen, however, mostly through the medical lens, which risks losing sight of other socially disadvantaged and marginalized groups. I think this is one of the main things that we need to think about when we are sort of reflecting upon the experience of this, of handling of the pandemic. And the role-specific duties of the leading three center around the short-term health and safety of the nation. And as the National Director of Health put it, it is up to the ministers to think about the wider picture of welfare and economy. The vaccination discussion generally, I think, has demonstrated that, unfortunately, solidarity is rather limited to the national borders. There's not been much discussion in Iceland about the importance of having fair distribution of vaccination around the globe. Now, finally, the public will factor. The pandemic was, of course, unexpected, and decisions were made quickly. The Troika had regular press meetings that caught the attention of the public. It is easy to sense the mood in Icelandic society, and it has been highly favorable. For example, the last poll, I think, showed 92% positive response to the policies here in Iceland. And generally, I don't know if that's just a coincidence, but at the same time, trust has increased generally towards public institutions and authorities. There was a collapse of trust in the wake of the financial collapse in 2008, but it has increased and substantially increased in the last year. Decision making was largely restricted to the Minister of Health, based on recommendations from the chief epidemiologist. Of course, other politicians and stakeholders were kept informed and listened to their views, but not included in decision-making. there is wide consultation in the making of contingency plans, which I think were very much in place. There all sorts of efforts are coordinated. And that has proved very successful in the handling of the pandemic here. On August 20th, a workshop was held by the Ministry of Health to consult with people from various social spheres about the continuing COVID-19 policies. And there were all very strong voices about the importance of taking sort of more general welfare into account, not only the sort of the narrow medical lenses that have been dominant, and it seems to have had some effect on policy. The National Director of Health says in an interview, it is not possible in the midst of a crisis to seek public consultation. It is urgent to act quickly, but it must be done in cooperation with society. And I think this has been characteristic. The chief epidemiologist also says the process is democratic in the sense that it is based on existing laws and contingency plans. Now, the Iceland case shows that there can be increased trust, public adherence, and policy effectiveness without open and inclusive decision-making. Here I am referring to a very good article by Nurheim and his co-writers and researchers in Bergen and other places, where they are providing arguments for the importance of open and inclusive decision making. That has not been practiced here during the pandemic, but I think partly in the preparation for a crisis of this kind, it has been done. And this one consultation meeting that I mentioned was sort of in this spirit. But as the chief epidemiologist says, when you need to take 1,000 decisions each day, it is impossible to view the matter from all perspectives. Then you lose control of the epidemic itself. In preparing for future health crisis, it would be desirable. I think that's perhaps what we need to really learn from this, that when we look ahead, that in preparing for future health crisis, which will certainly come, it would be desirable to include both a more diverse team of experts and members from the public to inform the preparatory policy work, contingency plans, and economic support for packages. This might include, for example, equality assessment of policies to find out views of people in elderly homes and disability groups more, how they, for example, may balance the importance of safety versus having interaction with their close ones, and the importance of mobility which I think was generally quite good in Icelandic society, because we have so much space for working outside. But if you are in a disability group that with mobile problems, then that can be different. Now, in conclusion, because of the relative success of the Icelandic approach, it has not been met with much criticism. The tendency for a prevailing mood in Icelandic society is double-edged. For example, the atmosphere before the financial collapse was very much characterized by herd behavior. And in this case of the pandemic, a crucial part of the success was this, that the mood was in favor of the policies, and it was very much sort of in fashion to be compliant with the Troika, which I think was well deserved, because they were very trustworthy in their policies. but it may also have contributed to a silencing of critical voices. This actually shows that I left out a very important one about trust, I think, which I had here in the beginning, that I think that there was the policies here were very much conducive to trust and compliance, which is not a prevailing feature in Icelandic society. And I made a distinction here between epistemic trust, when citizens have good reasons for believing the information provided, and recommendation trust, where they have good reason to follow expert recommendations and believe that they're in our best interest. And I think this requires personal characteristics. And I think we were very lucky with our Troika, how the PR aspect of their approach was very, very good and conducive to sort of informed compliance. Now, the media was very occupied with quantitative information, and perhaps should have provided more discussion about the reasons for policies, difficult trade-offs, and ethical issues. And this is something that I think lessons for the media for the future. Now, the policy decisions generally call for extensive research, where critical questions will be asked and lessons drawn. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Vilhjálmur.
Yeah, I have some references for that.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yeah. Okay. Thank you very much for this for a very interesting talk. And now it's time for Kristine Bærøe, who is our first commentator today.
sorry. Thank you. Does this work now?
Yeah.
Great. Okay, so thank you very much for inviting me to provide a comment on this very rich and useful presentation of Árnason. So what I'm going to focus on are these two topics, the role of trust and the role of experts from outside the healthcare sector. And I wanted to pick up on a very interesting observation, I think, from Árnason, namely that the Iceland case shows that there can be increased trust, public adherence and policy effectiveness without open, inclusive decision making. And my interpretation of that would be that it seems to have been openness in terms of transparency and invited criticism, but perhaps not inclusive decision making in the strict sense that although people were consulted and listened to, they did not actively take part in the reasoning and concluding part of the decision making process. So, but nevertheless, the decision makers, they were trusted. And this makes me think that maybe it could be that we can explain that by the fact that the scope and complexity of concerns involved in making these decisions actually make people recognize their own lack of ability to oversee all that goes into that kind of decision making and arrive at well-justified conclusions by themselves. And maybe therefore they are actually happy to leave this integration of all relevant concerns to an apparently well-functioning team of experts, perhaps together with politicians. I know I am, at least. So perhaps this aspect of some kind of gratitude could be something that it could be explored in how trust is played out during a pandemic. But anyway, in this setting, when one is more or less intellectually forced to leave the discretion over one's own interest in the hand of experts or policy makers, trust becomes perhaps more important than ever. Because without trust, people may not voluntarily comply with the restriction, and especially not so when there are heavy burdens to carry. So this led me to the very difficult concept of trust. Everyone who has tried to work on trust issues knows that it's extremely difficult to nail down in a definition. And I guess it's basically so because it's both a concept that can be directed towards different entities, people or institutions, but also it's heavily dependent on the context it is played out within. But I very much like this recommendation, trust, that you alerted to, Vilhjálmur. And this definition or this principle is captured in the following. If A has good reasons to believe B has good reasons to believe that a certain action is in A's interests, then A has good reasons to believe that they should perform that action. So this, of course, is a little bit complicated. So in order to try to make it a little bit more easy to grasp, I have colored the different beliefs in different colors here. And I think one thing is the complexity of the principle, but another thing is that we need also to translate what we actually mean by good reasons into real world context in order to translate this principle for practical use. And I would suggest that, for example, we could say that if B can demonstrate that B has justified reasons for this belief, And also that B will not do something that harms A's interests. And I think that must be a necessary condition because it's needed in order for A to have really good reasons to believe that B have good reasons, etc. Or alternatively, we could also go for a more stricter requirement, namely to say that B promotes A's interests, which is to ask for a little bit more. But I think maybe that it might be enough to look into the first one, that B will not do anything that harms A's.
Kristine, I'm sorry for interrupting, but
yeah.
Was there another slide you were going to show relating to what you're talking about now? Because we're seeing the one that is called topics. That... Oh,
sorry, yeah. I was just seeing that one. Okay, yeah. Then we must do something here. So can you see the different slides now?
Yeah.
Ah, perfect. Thank you. Okay, so this is Vilhjálmur's statement about the Iceland case and my interpretation of it. And this is a principle. This is a principle for accommodation trust, which was a little bit complicated. But in order to make it a little bit easier to understand, I divided the different beliefs into different color codes here. And I claimed that that was one of the challenges to really understand the principle. But the next one is that we really need to translate what it means to have good reasons into a real world context. And I suggest that this can be done by saying that if B can demonstrate that B has justified reasons for this belief, but also that B will not do something that harms A's interests. That's one claim that can be made, or it can be made even stronger by saying that B promotes A's interests. My point of view at this time, at least, would be that the first one might be a necessary condition and the next one might not be so. And I think this is what Arneson's point also indicated. So back to this paper that was mentioned earlier on, the paper on difficult trade-offs in response to COVID-19 that we wrote for Nature. And our point there was that we wanted to make the case that deliberative decision-making that is inclusive, transparent and accountable can contribute to more trustworthy and legitimate decisions. And what we implicitly argued for here was both the different kinds of ways that the two different conditions that I refer to according to the definition of trust could comply with. So the first one is, how can decision maker demonstrate that they will not do something that harms A's interests? And we argue there that this can be done by demonstrating willingness to make themselves accountable. And this, again, can be broken down to provide justification for measures, invite consultancy and critical scrutiny, arrange mechanisms for revision in light of new challenges and new evidence. And it can also be argued that accountability is realized by policymakers' ability to communicate clearly in order to allow for A's understanding of what is going on. And according to the other requirement, how can decision makers demonstrate that they promote A's interests? And here we come up with several different solutions to that. We claim that, well, it's not only the content of the decision that matters, it also matters how the decisions are made. This is the distinction between substantive and procedural fairness. And we say that decision-making processes that are transparent and also include those being affected by the measures give A the opportunity to inform decisions with their perspectives and experiences, which in turn improve the quality of the decisions. Also, they're given the opportunity to engage in deliberative processes that respect people's abilities to offer, appreciate and act on reasons. And this promotes self-esteem as a positive outcome. And also they have the opportunity to see burdens and benefits being justified as fair by being included in the processes, which in turn promote legitimacy, empirical and normative legitimacy. And they also have reason to believe that the authorities comply with legal obligations and human rights simply by the way that this procedure is designed, and this promotes moral equality and justice. So taken together, these different parts can be seen as something that promote trust, not only supportive, but also might promote trust, which is needed in order to adhere to the restriction on behavior that are necessary to curb the spread of the virus. Okay, so Arneson's observation that trust thrives without inclusion might then actually indicate that trust towards those maneuvering a pandemic only requires the minimum necessary condition of not doing something that harms A's interest, as opposed to the stricter requirement on promoting A's interest. And I thought that maybe that could be an interesting intake in order to explore further how trust is played out in under a pandemic, and how contextual factors impact on the phenomena of trust in such circumstances. Okay, so my last comment then is related to the role of experts. And from the keynote presentation, we heard that in preparing for future health crisis, it would be desirable to include a more diverse team of experts. So the question is then, what experts are required? And here I thought it could be useful to think about the different dimensions of trust that we have just gone through, both those who satisfy the requirement on not harming, and the other ones that even might promote the interests away. So in red here, I have captured all these different dimensions as accountability mechanism, clear and understandable communication, fair distribution of benefits and burdens, and stakeholders' involvement, public deliberation, and legal regulations. And these trust-relevant concerns, they are put on top of these two other concerns, namely knowledge about the nature of the virus that we need to establish, and also the practical and feasible and effective measures that follows from how this nature of the virus actually is. So while these two in colored in blue here seems to be the ones that we need to depart on in order to come up with a good solution to how to deal with the pandemic, I think also all these red dimensions need to be integrated with this blue concerns here. And then, of course, what is really interesting to try to manage to justify is what is going on in the middle here, where all these different concerns overlap each other. Again, I'm inspired by Arneson's nice diagram, but only done it a little bit more complicated. But I think that scientifically ideal interdisciplinary justification for a successful response to the pandemic really have to think about how all these different dimensions are integrated and how they can be optimized and balanced in the middle here. So, to the role of experts, I would say that a variety of disciplines and methods are needed in order to understand the role of trust in maneuvering this pandemic. And I think we can use this picture or this figure in order to go systematically through the different aspects and think about what kind of disciplines are needed in order to really, really dig into the nature of trust according to accountability mechanism, what is needed in order to promote clear and understandable communication, etc., and all the way through here. And I guess that will show that we need people from all the kind of departments. We need people from social sciences, psychologists, media experts, communications experts. We even need philosophers for the fair distribution part there. And we need anthropologists in order to understand how people perceive their positions according to the decision-making, etc. Legal scholars, of course, etc. So I think this perhaps can be a useful way to approach that question. And then finally, I would like to end this commentary by posing a very open question. Who should be assigned the task of identifying and integrating the overlapping concerns in the middle of this flower, that yellow aera? Who should be given that task? Should it be done systematically by experts? And if that is the case, who should be the experts to do that? Or should it be more in a more ad hoc manner by politicians? I don't know the answer to that question, but perhaps Arneson do. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Kristine. And I'm very happy that in the end, we managed to see all your great slides, because they really added a lot of value to your presentation. Yes, and if Janne just takes over now, and so then Janne, please, And I apologize again for the audience and all of you for these interruptions, but I'm sure it will all come through in the end. So Janne, please.
Okay, so I am going to give a few examples of why the justification of policy choices in a pandemic is quite a difficult endeavor, and perhaps also try to provide some answers if we look to human rights law. So I'm going to highlight some questions rather than some answers, and I'm going to touch quickly on the case of the Danish culling of the mink population, and the case of global shortage of vaccines, and how the market was enabled to address this in a timely manner, and then COVID passports. So in the autumn 2020, we had 12 cluster 5 cases of COVID identified in humans in North Jutland and Denmark. And by November, this new mutation had passed from minks to around 200 humans. Some of these humans were workers or families living on mink farms, but others were without direct contact. So it meant that there was a circulation of this mutation in society, in the population of North Jutland. And these mutations appeared to be less susceptible to antibody responses. So it raised fears that the vaccines that were much awaited would not be effective on this strain. Now, the problem was the scientific knowledge was preliminary, it was unproven, it was also disputed, but it came from our sort of chief epidemiologist, the SSI Institute, which is responsible for the Danish preparedness against infectious diseases. So the government ordered the culling of all minks, but as it turned out, shortly after, it was unclear if there was provision in the law to destroy healthy mink and not only mink that were sick. So the Prime Minister announced her intention to introduce fast-track legislation to provide a legal basis for culling all mink. It was not met with enthusiasm from all the other parties. They cited the lack of evidence and the need for time to reflect. But the Food Safety Authority, they continued to advise that all minks be destroyed. So one question was, of course, how much evidence is needed to justify far-reaching limitations on human rights, such as the right to property in this case. The SSI Institute considered that if we didn't cull the population of mink, they would pose a significant risk to public health. And coupled with this risk, states have obligations to protect the rights to health and life, but how much evidence is sufficient and how can the world afford to risk another novel disease outbreak? That was, of course, the reasoning. So an important question for further reflection. Then another issue is that a national solution to the pandemic must be global. We must have vaccines for all. And the question is intellectual property rights becoming a hindrance? So can we justify upholding intellectual property rights that monopolize for the few, or is it a problem for the many? So we already have agreements, the TRIPS agreement it's called, which allows states to grant compulsory licenses to patented inventions and to import and export products based produced under a compulsory license without the authorization of the patent holder if we have a national health crisis. So this compulsory licensing was actually used by South Africa and Nelson Mandela's government to ensure affordable access to HIV medicines in the beginning of the millennium. We do have one company, Moderna, which has pledged to abstain from enforcing patents as long as we are in the pandemic. Despite the continuous reports of shortages and delays in supply, in Denmark, we have had at least one company called Bavarian Nordic, which has not been able to make an agreement with other vaccine manufacturers, and the Danish government has also not mentioned compulsory licensing. So licensing agreements between Pfizer and Moderna and so on, you could argue that these have actually been made at a pace that has been too slow It's only last week, I think it was reported, that BioNTech is now making an alliance Europe-wide with the manufacturers that can help ramp up production. So the question is, how can societal interests and pharmaceutical innovation be aligned in the future? Of course, pharma has delivered on innovation, also with public money. It's like comparable to a moon landing that we have vaccines available and developed and produced so quickly after the first outbreak of COVID. But they have not been able to secure an adequate and timely supply. So that's another question that I throw up in the air, if we can justify upholding this monopoly. And then there is much talk about COVID passports, which also raises some questions of which principles can justify, should weigh more in the balancing. So for example, I think the digital solution for a COVID passport could be designed to afford protection to both privacy protection and to data reliability. It's just a matter of designing the app in a way that is conducive of both principles. But for example, for a physical COVID passport, for those who do not have a smartphone, it could be the case that we have to choose between privacy protection and data reliability. So for example, at the moment in Denmark, if you download your vaccination passport or your COVID passport, there is your name on it and your personal identification number. And it's stated if, you know, when did you get the vaccine or when did you get the test? And this has been problematized by some, that why do you need to have personal information on this passport? But on the other hand, if you were to remove name and personal identification number, I mean, you could just put your COVID passport in the photocopying machine, distribute it to all your friends, and then the point of having a COVID passport would really be non-existent, because then there wouldn't be trust. We would not have data reliability, and then why should we have this passport in the first place? If we look at the Syracuse principles, which have been developed to assist from a legal point of view, how can public health be a justification for infringements on fundamental rights? We have a number of pointers that such infringements, first of all, they must be according to law. I think most of the Nordic countries have already had or have procured under, as we went along in the pandemic, the relevant legal framework to work with this pandemic. Then it must be applied in a non-discriminatory way, which speaks to Vilhjálmur's focus on solidarity. It must be founded in compelling reasons of public health. It must be necessary, and this necessity has to be measured against scientific knowledge. Of course, the hard thing is, as I mentioned in the case of the culling of the mink, that there was conflicting scientific knowledge, and that makes it more difficult, of course. And then it has to be proportional in relation to the risk of infection, and it has to be the lesser of all evils in relation to protecting against the infectious disease. So those were sort of my input from a legal point of view on that.
So, but of course, because of these technical difficulties, we are running a little bit behind, but I do not want to close this webinar without an opportunity for a little bit of an exchange. So first, Vilhjálmur, how would you like to respond to the points raised by Janne and Kristine?
Well, first, Janne, which I think she sort of thank you both for your interesting comments and Ritz. Of course, I think it just like I provided my slides in advance, it actually would have been very good to have the commentator slides in advance, and because they were sort of rich with thing, I couldn't really take much down as I was listening. But Janne was sort of complimenting, I think, what I was saying, and everything she said about sort of the principles of public health and both the procedural and the substantial were just in line with what I was saying, and sort of the Danish examples. I don't know much about them, but I think the question she posed about the COVID passports, I think she provided herself very good reasons for emphasizing data reliability there. I think we are actually dealing with this question now in Icelandic society, and of course the principle of proportionality, that's the emphasized, I totally agree with. Now, Kristine had of course a very rich comment, and I actually, because I had read the article that she was basing her approach on, I agree with that article very much. I mean, I think it's right that it contributes to better decision making and more trustworthy decision making and sort of democratic legitimacy and fairness to have a very inclusive participation in it. But I guess what my question is about the timing. I mean, we have a pandemic that comes very quickly, and response has to be made based on. We were very lucky in Iceland, I think, to have sort of preparatory mechanism in place, which I described that it sort of has this combined efforts of epidemiology and disease control with emergency management, which I think has proved to be a very, I think, useful background for this. Now, of course, I agree, and I emphasized myself that in the wake of this, hopefully we will be able to say soon that this is over, and then when we are sort of learning the lessons from this whole affair, I think we need to take all this in sort of all this variety of voices that Kristine was mentioning from ethics, philosophy, welfare experts and disability people and perspectives of law and so on. I mean, all of this is extremely important. And of course, all these voices have been heard during the pandemic, but I mentioned this one workshop that was held in August last year in Iceland, and I think had some effect. But I think a major just practical problem, I'm not in disagreement about sort of the general issue here, but the practical problem is how are we to create the forum and the mechanisms to really sort of implement these into decision-making during a short and difficult pandemic? I think that's a very difficult question, and actually I think here we may have to choose between efficiency, which has proven to have gained very much trust and compliance, and for I think good reasons, because I think the performance of the Troika has been very trustworthy, and not compromising that, to risk compromising that by sort of diversing the voices and perhaps creating more controversies in a way in the policy implementations at that point. I mean, I know this is a risky argument, because you have so many good points about how to improve decision making. But I think when things are going so well and we are dealing very successfully with the situation, and the nation is over 90% happy with the way that this is done, I think we you know, I think we should, of course, I mean, we listen to these voices, but we should not change the way in which decisions are made during the time of the pandemic, but rather prepare ourselves better by adding the voices afterwards. I don't know if this is clear enough, but that's my main response.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much. And now I would also like to invite you, Kristine and Janne, if you would like to react to Vilhjálmur's response. We can allow ourselves 5 more minutes.
Would you start, Janne?
I don't have that many follow-up. I think our talks were pretty much in line and a good example of how ethics and law are intertwined, really. So maybe Kristine, if you have any comments?
Yes, I just wanted to emphasize that I very much agree with what you're saying, Vilhjálmur. And of course, this time perspective is super important. So what I tried to say was actually that maybe you have proved that we don't need to take all these kind of considerations into account during a pandemic, but maybe it's something we should learn from now and think more about for future catastrophes. So, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yes, thank you very much. I think we've narrowed down on at least one thing that we might call a conclusion here about the importance of contingency plans and raising all these questions about legitimacy and effectiveness and fairness and so on in that phase rather than when a crisis has actually hit, and then we don't have time to reflect on how to build a good ship when we're in the middle of a storm, right? Then we have to just use the one that we have. But we are, as I said, running behind schedule now. So I just want to now thank all of you for a very good contributions to this webinar, and this is a great part of our webinar series. And for the audience, I also want to then remind you of the next installment, which is on April 21st, and encourage you to visit our website and register for that event. Thank you very much.
Thank you.